I'm excited about this series. I mean, you guys know, if you've been here, you know that what I teach is kind of an overflow of what I'm learning and what I'm experiencing as I'm reading the Bible. And so I'm just sharing that with you. And this whole series comes out of a conversation I had with a friend of mine who brought up just the idea that Jesus has always been there, right? If you read John 1:1. Actually, John tells us that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And you think about that idea. Think about that idea for a second. The Word, he's talking about Jesus, has always been there. Jesus is God and was with God in the beginning. He's always been there. And I think sometimes, at least for me, like I know that he's there. I mean, I know the idea, and I think about it, but I begin to see things differently. I begin to go through the Old Testament and be aware of some things that I hadn't really seen before. And so we're gonna talk about that in just a second. But that idea, see, we think of Jesus sometimes as just that baby. He was born, right? God with us, Emmanuel. He'd come and he's born and he grows up. He's an adult, and then he sacrifices his life on the cross, and he's dead, and he's buried, he's resurrected, and we see Jesus as that person. But John tells us that he's always been. We just didn't call him Jesus. He's always been there. And the awareness of that fact was extremely eye-opening to me. So I'm very excited about what we're going to talk about. Let me try to relate this in some way to you, I guess. My son, my oldest son, is about to turn 12. He turns 12 this month. Now, I'm freaking out a little bit because he's like a teenager almost. He's almost as tall as me. He wears the same size shoe I do, right? And he's still 11. 11 and a half shoe. I don't know how many 11-year-olds wear 11 and a half shoe. He wears, it's crazy. His foot is gigantic. And I think about where I was, what I was doing, who I was 12 years ago. It's so unbelievably different than who I am, where I am, what I'm doing today. I mean, it's crazy to think how much different 12 years ago was for me personally than where I am today. And I think about if someone had tried to explain to me what 12 years from now would have looked like, if somebody had come and said, hey, let me tell you what it's going to look like in 12 years, I probably would have laughed because it's so crazy. I'd live in a different city. I'd be a pastor of a church. Just even the idea that my kid would be 12, and I know he's going to grow up, right? I mean, I get that that we have to grow up. I know how teenagers are going to be, right? I know what is coming. But there's something that makes me feel like he's not going to be that way. Is anybody else think like that? Like, I see other teenagers, and I'm like, all teenagers are crazy except my teenager, right? I know how I was, and I was not good. And so I don't know why in my brain I don't think that my son is going to be like that. But if I'm listening to people, if I'm paying attention to my own past, if I'm paying attention to the experience I've had with teenagers, I would be aware of that stuff, but I miss it because I'm like, no, it's going to be different. It's going to be different. It's going to be different, even though I know really it's not, right? And I think back on all the lessons that I've learned, and I think about the conversation I had before he was born, and people trying to explain to me what it was like to have kids, right? To be taking care of kids and how time flies. And I nodded like I knew, right? I nodded like I had a comprehension of what they were talking about. I don't even like to have conversations about having kids with people who don't have kids because I remember not getting it until I held my son for the first time. I'm like, oh my goodness. I mean, you guys have you have kids. You have that same experience with me? Like, it was such an amazing difference. Like, I thought I loved my son until I held my son, right? Okay? And then I held my son. I'm like, wow. Like what I thought was love was nothing compared to what I have right now. And I think about all the advice and lessons that it was given to me that I ignored, that now I'm trying to give to him that he's ignoring, that all the stuff that was poured into me that I'm trying to do the same thing. And I'm just, man, if you could just be aware of what is coming, if you could just understand, but he can't. I can't talk to him about what it's like to be an adult because he's not been an adult. I'm trying to get him to understand it, but until he's experienced it, it's not going to happen, right? I mean, we've probably all experienced moments like that where we if we'd have known the day before, All right. If we'd had the knowledge and the wisdom before the day before, we maybe not would not have made the decision. But once we made the decision, it was kind of too late. Like, oh my goodness, I wish I hadn't have done that. Or oh, that's what my parents were talking about. Oh, that's what those people were trying to tell me not to do. All right, anybody? Just me? Am I the only one? Okay. So I've had plenty of moments like that. Plenty of moments where it was like an aha moment, and I never see it. I never see it when it's right in front of me. It's always like I have to look in the rearview mirror. And I think about my son, and this one moment that just stands out to me when like so many things just became clear, like it all made sense. All the reading of the Bible and hearing about God's son and hearing about the Father and all of that, it didn't make sense to me until the day I clipped my son's fingernail and made it bleed, all right? I was clipping it. You know, baby's fingernails are like razor blades. You guys ever had baby's fingernails? You're supposed to put like mittens on, right? But the mittens kind of weird looking, and I was holding him, and he was in my. It was like Freddy Krueger across my face. It was like scratched my face up. Little razor blades. I'm not sure why God gives babies razor blades for fingernails. It's like maybe they should just be nubs until they're older, like 13, and then they develop fingernails. I don't know. But they scratched my face, and it hurt, and I had like band-aids on my face. And so I'm clipping his fingernails. And had this real special, you know, like gigantic little baby, had a magnifying glass so you could see the tiny finger. And I'm clipping the fingernail, and I clipped a little too close, and it bled just a little bit, right? And he cried. And I was so devastated that, A, I made him bleed just a little bit. And then he was crying. And I'm like, oh, what have I done? Oh, what have I done? I'm so sorry. And I'm frantic. I'm getting a Band-Aid. And he's crying. And I'm patting his back. It's like, oh, it's okay. I'm so sorry. Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. And it was like no blood. I mean, it just barely went away. It's just a little bit of pain. And it just hit me in that moment. Just hit me. Jesus, the Son of God, his Father, what he had to endure. I mean, the little clip of a fingernail is nothing compared to the cross and the beating and the shame and his Father to watch it. I mean, it's like all of it, he had to do it. And like, I never really grasped it. Like, I've heard the analogy of Father and Son, but until I had a son, and now I use that analogy all the time. Like, I get it. But it took like in the moment to get it. And so I read this passage we're going to read, and I think about what Jesus is trying to get his disciples to see, that they're just not seeing. They're just totally missing. In fact, let's look at it right here. Let's look at it. Jesus is talking. He was crucified. He was buried. He's resurrected. He's come back, and he's speaking to his disciples. And in verse 25, he says to them, "Oh, foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ, the Messiah, should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" See, they don't understand why he had to do what he had to do, and he's been explaining it for 3 years. I mean, he's been trying to teach it, and they're like, they don't get it. In verse 27, this is huge. Look, "And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." So Jesus, it's like, but guys, I've been saying this over and over again. Why are you not getting it? All right, let's just go back to the beginning. Because when it says beginning with Moses, he's not talking about just the story of Moses. He's talking about what Moses wrote. And that's the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, Numbers, that's the Torah. So he says, let's begin with Moses. Let's go back, okay? Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, all right? Let's start there. And it says he in the prophets. So he's looking at all the Old Testament. That's when he's talking about the scriptures. He's talking about the Old Testament. So he goes through all the scriptures and shows them all the things concerning him. It's like, look, you see right here in Genesis, you see where it's talking about the seed of the woman that'll crush it? That's what I did. All right, that's prophecy, right? Look, keep turning it. You see right here, you see Abraham? You see, look, that's me, okay? That's what he's talking about. That's the promise. Look, let's keep going. He's pulling it out. And they missed it. They're standing with him. I mean, they're watching him perform miracles. They're living life with him. He's teaching it and preaching it, and they're missing it. He's having to go back and show them again. And I still think, especially when we look at Acts 2, I mean, they kind of get it, but I feel like he's showing it, and they're going, yeah, that's good, Jesus, that's good. We have this book to show us what God has done for us, what God has promised us, who God is, what he has done, what he will do. We have this book, and then we have a more complete version of the story than they even had, because they just had the Old Testament. Now we have the story of Jesus. We have these eyewitness accounts to point back to who he was and what he did. And the Old Testament, the scripture that they used. And what Jesus is telling his disciples is like just like in John 1:1, as the author of John is trying to make the point, Jesus has always been there. He's always been there from the very beginning. In Luke chapter 10, it says that Jesus saw Satan fall from heaven. And maybe taking that out of context, but the idea is that Jesus was at the very beginning. He is God. He was not created. And if we hold on to Jesus, just this idea of this baby that was born and grew up to be a man, we miss that there's so much more that God has done. There's so much more preparation. There's so much more investment in the world than just this baby being born. Now, it's necessary. He had to come. It's the only redemption possibility. The only one who could rescue us. The only one who could provide the perfect sacrifice was God himself. But you go back to the beginning and begin to flip through and look story after story after story, and you see that God was preparing for it. God had a plan. God did not abandon us. He did not forsake us. And it's unbelievable. And I know you pick up your Bible and you're like, man, it's just so boring. You get to Leviticus, like, what is this? You read some of the genealogies, like, I don't care who begat who. And it's hard to read. But God gave us this so we could see it and know it. And he's even telling his disciples, guys, go back and see. I'm there. The truth is there. The gospel is there. God's love is there. So that's what I want to do in this series. I want us to go back and look at some of these stories where God kind of shows up in ways that we might miss if we're not really paying attention. And so there are three ways, okay? There are three things that, and I had to write some of this stuff down. I couldn't memorize all of this, all right? So I'm going to stand behind you and read this so you get it. There are several ways to go back through the Bible and see Jesus from beginning to end. But I want to talk about three ways that we can go to the Old Testament and we can pull out and see Jesus, see how God was clearly planning his arrival. One of the best ways is through prophecy. Now, you've heard us say that before, and we've talked about prophecy being fulfilled. But let's just hit on some big ones, all right? Some of the ones that I think are really, really fantastic. That prophecy is the idea of foretelling something or predicting something would come true, all right? So if we were just taking the Bible and we were opening it up and we were reading all the Old Testament said, would it point to Jesus? Does it say that who Jesus is, who the Old Testament said would come? Well, let's look at some prophecies, all right? So the first one that I think is interesting is in Micah 5:2. And Micah 5:2 says that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. Now, I haven't been to Bethlehem. I've been near Bethlehem. Bethlehem is not a very big town. It would have been a little bit like Jesus saying, the prophet Micah saying, Jesus is going to come to Nelson, Georgia. Well, we might know where Nelson is, right? But it's not a large city. There's not a lot of people there. And it's pretty interesting that he picks a city. Didn't just say he's coming. He says he's coming to this city. He will be born in this town. I don't even know if it's big enough to be a town. I read somewhere that they estimated like the average population of Bethlehem was around 7,000 people. Town, small town. So it's fulfilled because we read in Matthew he was born in Bethlehem. And Luke, Malachi is another one. Malachi says in Malachi 3:1, in the first part of verse 1, that there would be a messenger who would come and prepare the way for the Messiah. And we have John the Baptist who comes and prepares the way for Jesus and baptizes him into ministry. And so we have that prophecy fulfilled. And I think it's great. Now, maybe that's not such a stretch because you think, okay, well, you could prophesy that somebody would come or prepare for someone else. But you start stacking these on top of each other, and it starts to get pretty fantastic. Zechariah says a whole lot. In Zechariah 9:9, he says that he would come to his people on a donkey. And that's exactly what he did. When he rode into Jerusalem, he rode on the back of a donkey. That's kind of specific because it's not a camel, right? It's not a cart. It's on a donkey. A donkey is a common animal, all right? But you're talking about the Messiah, and a donkey is not necessarily an animal for a king. So to prophesy that the Messiah would come to his people riding a donkey, all right, well, okay, I'll take that. I'll take that. Let's see. Zechariah also said that in 13:6 that he would be betrayed by his friends. And we know that he was betrayed by Judas, and Peter denied him. Zechariah went on to say that betrayal would include 30 pieces of silver. Now that's specific. Not just he would be betrayed with money, he would be betrayed with 30 pieces of silver. Guess how many pieces of silver Judas took to betray Jesus? 30. Now wait, it gets even better than that, because Zechariah, the prophet, says when he's giving the prophecy, he says that the 30 pieces of silver will not be accepted, and they can't be returned, and they'll be thrown on the floor and used to used for the potter, and how he says it. So when you take the story that is revealed in Matthew, you see that Judas had the 30 pieces of silver, and he felt so guilty after turning Jesus over that he returned the money to the Pharisees, who wouldn't take it. He's like, that's blood money, we can't take it. So what does he do? He throws the 30 pieces of silver on the temple floor, to which they pick it up and they buy land that's called the Potter's Field. That's pretty stinking specific. Let's keep going. And this is just a few. I don't even have time to go through them. Some scholars show that there's like 350 prophecies that Jesus alone fulfilled. I wish we had that much time. But that's why you read it. Okay, let's keep going. Isaiah prophesied that the Messiah would give no defense when he was brought to his trial. That's Isaiah 57:3. And he doesn't. When Pilate asks him if he wants, he's like, look, let's go. I'll set you free. And he's like, no. He's like, are you the king of Jews? You want to lie? You want to let go? It's like, I am. Who do you think I am? Isaiah said that the Messiah would be born a virgin. Isaiah 7:14. Again, fulfilled through Mary. Malachi wrote in the second half of the first verse, chapter 3, that the Messiah would enter the temple. Now, this is fascinating to me. Let me go back to the virgin birth one for just a second. It's if you start collecting all these prophecies, you look at him, 30 pieces of silver, his friends would betray him, he's got to have a messenger that comes up, he's going to be born in a small little town, and you start stacking them, and then you throw in like the virgin birth, it's like they're trying it to be impossible. It's like they're trying to make that, like this can't happen, right? Because there's just too many crazy things. This one is great. The Malachi says that he would enter the temple. And he says that 400 years before Jesus was born. And Jesus goes to the temple. We read about it. He visits the temple several times. He is there. Well, 70 years after his ascension, roughly, I don't know, 40 years after his ascension, the temple of Jerusalem is destroyed. And so if you're taking all these prophecies and what the Old Testament is, there couldn't possibly be a Messiah after that unless they rebuilt the temple, because he has to enter the temple, which you can't do right now, because the temple has not been rebuilt. So it had to happen before that. You look at Psalm 22:16-18, it foretells the crucifixion of the Messiah. 800 to 1,000 years before crucifixion was even a method of execution practiced. And how many people are being crucified right now? So to take scripture and look at all the things that had to happen for a single individual to say they were the Messiah, it couldn't even happen today. But Jesus meets them all. In fact, listen to this. So there's these two guys named Peter Stoner and Robert Newman, and they wrote a book called Science, what was it? It's called Science Speaks. And the whole book is about probability. It's about looking at numbers and determining what the probability of one act, one action is, right? And so they took Jesus and the prophecies foretold about him, and they just took eight, the ones that we just mentioned, minus the virgin birth. They took eight prophecies that they could test, like Bethlehem. They can look at records and determine kind of the average number of people attended, times how many years, and so they can multiply that and say, okay, well, so many people have existed in the town of Bethlehem, so one person being born in Bethlehem in all of history would be one in so many, whatever many people, right? And so they do all this math, and they try to determine, and they stack them on and on. So what they determine is the probability of just eight prophecies, just the ones that we read, eight prophecies. It would be 10 with 17 zeros. One in that many, that large of a number. I don't even know what the name of that number is. I don't even know if they have a number for that name, name for that number. 10, it's like 1,000,000, like 17. Is that that many zeros? It's ridiculous odds. And they go on to say that if you take 8 more prophecies, well, you're basically doubling that number. So now it's 10 to 34 zeros. And so they said, look, what if we take just the 50 most prominent prophecies on Jesus that we can look at and see that he was foretold to have, he was told in the New Testament to have fulfilled clearly with no debate, right? The 50 that were sure. You know what the number is? It's 10 with 157 zeros after it. That one person would fulfill all those prophecies. It's statistically impossible. But he did it. So you see that God was not just sitting around waiting for Jesus to come. To have Jesus born and to live the life and to die on the cross. It wasn't that he was sitting around doing nothing. He was constantly telling you, listen, I've got a plan. Listen. You need to do it this way because I've got a plan. Listen to me. This is going to happen. Write this down. Other people need to know this. Prophecy. It's huge. A second way to go through the Old Testament and see Jesus in the text is a term called typology. And typology is when you see events or persons as like a foreshadowing of Jesus. And this is fantastic because you can look at prophecies from Genesis on and you can look at stories from Genesis on and see that the foreshadowing of what Jesus would be, the person he would be, the sacrifice that he would pay on the cross, what he would do is a story that's been told from the very beginning. It is not a random act that came out of nowhere. It is all connected. It is a common thread. So let me give you some examples. So Adam was made perfect, right? But then he sinned and brought sin and destruction and death. And because he did not choose to obey God fully and brought sin, destruction, and death, we needed rescuing. We needed a redeemer. Thus, Jesus, the final Adam to bring justification, redemption, and life. Look at Abel. Cain and Abel, right? Abel suffered for the sake of righteousness, so did Jesus. Noah stood with God, faced rejection to save his family, so did Jesus. Job was tested by God when tempted by the devil. His suffering was for a greater good. The same with Jesus. Abraham had an eternal covenant and promises that must be fulfilled. Fulfilled by who? Fulfilled by Jesus. Fulfilled by Christ. Isaac, his birth was from supernatural intervention. So was Jesus. He was asked to sacrifice his life. The only other person God asked to sacrifice his life. Same with Jesus. Moses led his people from bondage into God's protection. Jesus did the same through his death, burial, and resurrection. Joshua, the savior of the covenant people. Jesus is the savior of his covenant people. David is too many to list. I mean, you go on and see the facing the giants and the king and all the perils. You can look at Elijah, you can look at Elisha, Nehemiah, Jonah, Jeremiah, Daniel. I mean, you look, it's the picture of who Jesus would be is painted clearly throughout almost every story in the Old Testament. And that doesn't even include the events. That doesn't even include things like the 10th plague, the Passover, which is the blood of the lamb will save you. What Jesus is the lamb, his blood shed will save you. I mean, you go down the list. You go you have the Moses striking the rock in the wilderness that provided the life-sustaining water. Jesus was struck and provides the life-sustaining water. That's what he says in John 4, that the water that he provides will quench your thirst forever. You have a manna from heaven, which is, who is the bread of life? It is Jesus. You've got Jacob's ladder, which is that personal connection and communion with God. That's what Jesus did, tore the veil from top to bottom and gave us personal access to God. You got parallels to the things like the tabernacle and all the components of the tabernacle that point to Christ. The three offices that Jesus, proclaimed in the prophet, the priest, and the king. And you are only supposed to be one of those three, but Jesus was all three. You can't not read the Old Testament and see Jesus over and over and over again. The third, so you got prophecy and you have typology. And the third way, or a third way, I mean there's other ways to see Jesus. The third way that I want to focus on And this, to me, is the most fascinating. And this is where we're going to spend our time in the weeks to come to focus on. It's called theophany. Now, I didn't know they had a word for this, and I had to look this up. Theophany, see, you're nodding because you know what I'm talking about. Theophany is the word given for a manifestation of God in human form, in human senses. Now, this is not to be confused with God incarnate, Jesus, Son of God in the flesh, right? The who came as a human being, 100% human, that is Jesus. But before that, he didn't have the name Jesus. He was given the name Jesus as a baby boy. Before that, he was just the Son of God. He was just there. He was. He didn't have the name Jesus. And so this idea of theophany is God coming and presenting himself, sometimes in human form, in appearance of a human. Sometimes he had to be in physical human form to do the things that he did. And it's mesmerizing when you read it. But if you're not paying attention, you just miss it. Because it doesn't say Jesus. It says things like the glory of the Lord or the angel of the Lord. That's the big one. That phrase, the angel of the Lord. So the Hebrew word for angel is malach, right? It means messenger. And so you see that word used often. And when you see angel, my immediate thought when I read angel, and maybe you guys think this too, there's giant wings and a little gold harp, right, and a white dress. Okay, that's what I think. So when I read angel, that's what I see in my head, okay? So if I'm reading the Old Testament and I come across something that says angel of the Lord, I'm looking at guy, you know, some dude in a white dress and wings and a harp and who's a messenger. But there's a difference. There's a clear difference between when it says angels, like those who visited Lot to get him out of the house before God rained down on Sodom and Gomorrah. The angels that appeared to Mary and Joseph, who had names, okay? Angels that are messengers throughout the Old Testament, that's a difference because it's just angels. An angel, a messenger. But then you have this phrase, the angel of the Lord. And what's interesting about that phrase is that of the 245 references in the Old Testament of angels, in the whole Bible, a third of them apply to this angel of the Lord phrase. And that phrase, almost every time, when it speaks or when it interacts, it does not speak as a messenger of God, like, I am saying this, thus saith the Lord, like a prophet, right? The Lord said to tell you this, okay? I am speaking this, thus saith the Lord. That's not what it says. The angel of the Lord speaks, and he says, I am here with you. I will do this. I will fix that. And it speaks with authority and with power, and it speaks that phrase as if the angel of the Lord is God, because I believe it is. And now, what's fascinating about that is you see over and over again instances where God appears and interacts and talks and hangs out with people just like Jesus did, but he's just hanging out temporarily in the moment. It's amazing. Now you've got instances where the glory of the Lord is like in a burning bush. That's a popular one, right? Because maybe that's the Holy Spirit, because it's not in human form. It's just there. You've got the glory of the Lord in a pillar of smoke or a fire, right? So that's more like the Holy Spirit, because it's not in human form. But when we think about Jesus in human form, and we see the angel of the Lord that shows up to Hagar. Do you know who Hagar is? Hagar. All right, let's get a little bit of history here. So Hagar is the bondservant of Sarah. Sarah is the wife of Abraham. Abraham and Sarah were told and promised by God that they would have children. And Sarah kind of lost faith, had lost trust, and she was frustrated, and she wanted to have children and kind of gave up. And so she told Abraham to take her bondservant and have her bondservant. And that's a whole real crazy story right there. But the bondservant gets pregnant, and Sarah gets mad, and we're going to look at that story next week. Listen, she goes to the stream, and it says the angel of the Lord finds her at the stream and sits down and talks to her. She sees him as a human. She sees him as a person, talks to him. You see instances where Abraham sees the glory of the Lord. It says the angel of the Lord appearing in three persons outside his tent, and he goes, and they walk and converse. You see it over and over again. You see it in the story of the stories that we're going to look at in Jacob, where it says that Jacob wrestled God. Was he wrestling thin air? No, he was wrestling something. He was wrestling the angel of the Lord. You see Balaam riding his donkey. We'll look at that story too, because the donkey stops because the angel of the Lord is standing in the road and won't let him pass. is speaking to Balaam. You see with Samson's parents, the angel of the Lord appeared to them. You see with Gideon. You see with Daniel, the angel of the Lord closed the mouth of the lions. You see in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they put three men in the furnace. They opened the door, and there were four men standing there. Over and over and over again, God is interacting, is prevalent with his creation, with his people. And the lessons that we can learn from that, the magnitude of what is being taught in those stories is fantastic. And that's where we're going to be. That's where we're going to be over the next several weeks. We're going to look and see how God has been invested and been involved in the lives of his people, his chosen ones, his called out, even those who were not a part of his plan, those that he still interacted with, because not the, everyone's a part of his plan. I'm sorry, I'm going to step back. Those that he just wanted to bless, that weren't necessarily on the right path. I'm thinking about Hagar and how her son was Ishmael, and that was not the exact plan that God had for Isaac, and how God has been there, and he is blessing, and he is involved, and he is invested, and it tells us that it's not an accident. It tells us that it's not happenstance. It tells us that it's not random. And it tells us that God, as invested as he was then, is still invested now. That he loves us so much that he would come and make sure that everything was done the way it needed to be done. And he is still interacting and involved in your lives now. He wants us to read this and know this, to know him and to trust him and to recognize that if he would be there for those people we'll read about in these stories, that he'll be there for you. He is there for you. You look and you read these stories like, how could God love that person? Because God loves you too. God loves. This book is so unbelievably important. It's too important not to read. The message that it contains is so valuable. The answers that it provides are immeasurable. We need to read it. We need to look at it. So we're going to go in the next couple weeks, and we are going to pour into these stories. We're going to pull them out, and we're going to see God in these theophany moments in Scripture of where he is interacting and places that we might miss it and not pay attention to what God is teaching in that moment. It's going to be great. So a lot of great Old Testament stuff. I'm going to be pulling it out. It's going to be a lot of fun. So I hope you guys will come back for this series. I hope you'll come back the next several weeks, because we're going to take it all the way to the birth of Jesus, when God does come in the flesh, Emmanuel, God with us. And that being the exclamation point to all of his involvement before then. I hope that you see that this book is not irrelevant, that these stories are not out of date, that what God wants us to learn from this is not something that only applies to past generations. It applies to us today. He is so invested and so concerned about his creation and every single heart and every single soul. All he asks is that we will just love him and trust him. My prayer is that you will do that. Take your Bible, open it up. Let's read it together. Let's dive in and look at some of these stories, and may they change our lives. Will you pray with me?